Let's start our morning discussion on securing cyberspace. What's next for India? So, as you all know, that the subject is an increasingly important one. But of course, the importance of the subject is not matched by sufficient depth of knowledge in most countries. And I think it's still a fairly very closed space. But I think we at the ORF are trying to develop, I mean, at least create greater awareness in India. We run a cyber monitor. We run an annual conference called Sci-Fi Cybersecurity Conference, where we bring in international participants. So I think it's been our objective to promote a more wider, deeper discussion of cyber-related issues, which have become so important for everyone in the world. Now, I think the nature of the issues involved, both on the, because it involves both security as well as on the civilian side. So securing is not just about securing the traditional sense of national frontiers, but it's also about securing an environment in which commerce can thrive, because today internet connects all of us, and that life without internet is unimaginable. And internet has become the sinews of global connectivity and part of our life. But I think with the new issues that have emerged out of security, both in its most expansive terms, we've seen increasing frequency of attacks on cyber systems, increasing jockeying between different governments, and a range of other issues, including what should be the nature of the relationship as we move towards greater security, what should be the nature of the relationship between government and the corporate sector. That does securing critical infrastructure, should there be only be limited to the government infrastructure, or if the private sector is involved, what is the nature of the relationship? I mean, a whole range of issues relating to secrecy, question of copyright, and a range of other things that are coming in the way in which the governments relate to the corporate sector. And then, of course, there are the issues of state versus citizen in terms of what the state does, how does it secure the collective, vis-a-vis the rights of the individual in the cyberspace. I mean, I think that's been another major source of debate in the international system. And then there is the larger question of great power conflict or rivalry within the cyber domain. Here again, I think there has been an expanding debate in the international system of what kind of arms control, shall we say, or cyber confidence building measures that we can develop in the coming years. Are there possibilities for a new codes of conduct in the international system, both at the multilateral level as well as at the bilateral level? And then linked to all this, of course, is the nature of the internet and the question of who governs it. Right now, the nature of the internet is going, the system, at least part of it, is now seeing a transition from American primacy to a broader system in which the rest of the world is going to get involved. And the ICANN transition that has been announced some time ago, that has provided the basis for discussion. Here again, who's going to decide the rules? I mean, is it the states? Does the private sector, the civil society, should it have a role? Whether it should be multilateral or multi-stakeholder? All these debates are taking place. So I think to discuss some of these issues this morning, we have two very eminent speakers. We have Latha Reddy, who's a former Deputy National Security Advisor of India. And before that, she had a distinguished career in the Indian Foreign Service. She served as our ambassador in Portugal, in Thailand, and served in many, many other places. But I think in the final years, when I think she was in the National Security Secretariat as a Deputy National Security Advisor, leading the effort to create a framework for cybersecurity within India. And she's also today a commissioner of the Global Commission for Internet Governance and is associated with the East West Institute, New York. Above all, she's associated with us at the ORF. But she lives in Bangalore, but welcome back to Delhi. I would also like to welcome Gabi Siboni, who's the Director of Military Strategic Affairs and Cyber Affairs at the Institute of National Security studies Israel.
The credential is longer than mine.
I think we have a long partnership between ORF and the INSS. So welcome, sir. Thank you.
Internet issue, but more of the security issue, which our internet is only a small part of cybersecurity. So during the course, just a background to give you that, during the course of last year, I've been commissioned by a large financial institution here in India to run an audit on cybersecurity and ICT systems, during which we have proposed to implement what I call a concept that I've developed, which is integrated cybersecurity. Under the concept, we understand that you cannot distinguish between cybersecurity and physical security. They are going all together. And the main vulnerability of cybersecurity is, not surprisingly, the human being. So as we all think that cybersecurity is about technology, so at the end of the day, cybersecurity is more about human being conduct and less about technology. So this is just to open my words. Okay, I'll start with with cybersecurity, we have, when you try to cope with cybersecurity, you have a lot of information, a lot of data, and you try to digest this data and to try to get what we call situational awareness. What is going on with your system? Any system, trying to defend any system to make sure that your system maintain its functionality and to maintain the system's let's say ability to continue to do either, if you're in a business organization or you are in a security organization or you are in any, you know, bank or exchange or whatever, you will want to have your system continues to be operated and function without any flaws. So doing that, you need a lot of data to understand the situation of your system. Before I dive into this Laplace demon, I just want to say two words about the kind of attacks that we are facing. Attacks are not only launched through the internet. They can be launched, as I said, by internal employees' activity, both intentional and non-intentional. So some cybersecurity incident events may be caused by unintentional behavior of employees. That should be understood. So we when we're talking about intentional cyber activity, we normally distinguish them between two categories. The first is what we call surface attacks, and then what we call deep attacks. Surface attacks is all this family of DDoS, of denial of service, of defacement, all these families that you normally work wide. You work with a wide attack capabilities, and you try to get, in the end, small results. It means that you will probably end up with some kind of denial of service for some time, but nothing. You will not harm very much your victim. The other attacks is what we call deep attacks. Deep attacks is normally attacks that are dedicated and are developed specifically for a victim or for a rival or for an organization. You want to achieve something. So those deep attacks are normally, maybe you know the word used by APTs, the Advanced Persistent Threats, which are developed specifically for a certain target. And those normally, typically, there is no way to detect them once they've been launched. And if you wait for them to happen, then you will detect them only by seeing what is the consequence of this attack, okay? So when you have those two families and you try to manage yourself, how to protect yourself, there is a lot of data and information within your system. So I just wanted to open with the Laplace demon. Laplace was a mathematician and an astronomer in the 90s, beginning of the 19th century. So he said that there was, you know, the movement equations, equations of movement. If anyone learned physics a little bit, you would know that if you have the boundary conditions or initial conditions of any system, then you can predict very well what will happen to the system. So, for example, if we have a coin and we throw the coin, if we know all the parameters, That's a big if we know the friction, if we know the humidity, if you know the pressure, if you, we know our fingers' geometry. So if we know all of them, it will not be a chance to predict what is the on what side will the coin fall. However, we don't know that. So Laplace took mathematics to the extreme and said, if we would have known everything, we could predict everything. However, in our life, we don't know, and then we have to rely on statistics. So many of our, what we call physical laws, are based on statistics because we don't know exactly the conditions. So this is the same in cyberspace. We have a lot of information. However, we don't know what the meaning of this information, and we can't predict exactly what is going on. It's like this big data issue. Look at the elephant. I think it's an Indian. It's an Indian, yeah. I would be happy if someone tells me what is the origin of this concept. However, if you know that the blind scientist trying to figure out what is an elephant, then that's just by feeling, and then everybody sees something else that you can see, and there is no integrated, and no one can make an integration without being out of the system. So this is where we stand in cyberspace. We all understand small portions of the problem, and we don't have any way of understanding the full picture. So what you see now, the characteristics of cyberspace, is that we have a lot of information. The volume of information is increasingly large. We have a lot of information, a lot of data to analyze. The speed of data, the change, and the speed is enormously high, and the variety of information is enormously scattered. So it means that we have a lot of sources of information coming to us in a high speed, an increasingly speed rate, and the volume is huge. So now we try to understand, go to our elf and try to understand what we do with this, and to understand our situation. So if you are in corporate and you try to understand your cybersecurity situation and try to analyze all these all the data that you gain with your systems, that will be a very difficult a challenge. So here you see the big data, and what we would like to know is how to reduce or to extract from this big data only the relevant data that we need for our security. Now, another issue is, as I mentioned, physical security is an important part of cybersecurity, or what we say security as a whole is composed of cybersecurity and physical security. For example, it's not only a slogan. For example, if you take a building, you know that systems are connected. For example, your data centers, they need to be cooled. If they are not cooled, what will happen to the computers? They will be shut down. So if your cooling system is malfunctioning, you'll probably end up with having a big cyber event, cyber incident, where all your system is down. And you have to make sure that your system is protected against this kind of incidents. However, these are incidents that normally, when you look at cybersecurity, you will not consider. You know, which are the least secured network in any organization? Any ideas? Please?
Industrial control systems.
Please? What we found out, that the least secure network in any organization will be the physical network. The cameras are controlled by a network. The access control, if you go to a door and you need to open it and you have to put your tag, so this is controlled by a network. The SCADA system that controls your cooling system, the chillers of the data centers, that controls your elevators, that controls every aspect of your physical conduct in your premises, they are all controlled by a network, and we found out that this network is the least protected network, because companies and the corporates, they tend to think that they should, protect their business network. A bank will protect its business functionality network, and it will neglect. No, they are neglecting the physical part of it. Well, from our experience, this is a very big vulnerability. And when you try to understand that, you have to understand that you have to combine all those systems all together. So what we say now that, let's say, for example, financial facility cybersecurity. DHS, the Department of Homeland Security in the United States, they should be addressed the same way as cybersecurity should be addressed. Now, I would just want to one point regarding the overflow of that data. We are in any business. If you go to any security department of a bank or of a corporate, or be it an intelligence organization, doesn't matter, you will see that there is a lot of data, as I mentioned, all this big volume in high speed is coming, and you try to digest that information. So normally we would have thought that if you have a lot of as much information you will have, the better decision you will take. This is the simple chart that is shown here. However, this is not the situation, as you can understand. The real situation is that in a certain point, you are overflown with information. Once you are overflown with information, your ability to decide and the quality of your decision reduces quite rapidly. And the challenge is to find where to stop with this information, where to stop your information, where is your comfort zone of information. This is really a big challenge. And it's a challenge not only in cyberspace, it's a challenge in any information-based conduct, be it a commander in the field. You know, now we have a lot of computerized systems providing the tactical commander with information, or be it a CISO of a bank that he has so many systems that provide him with a lot of information, and he tries to find himself, you know, wants to take good decisions in real time. And his ability reduces if he doesn't have any way of trying to reduce the noise that he's got from his system. You know that typical banks, they will have tens of security devices, different security devices. And normally if you go to a CISO, the chief information security officer, and ask him what kind of devices, defense devices you have, he would not be able to mention that. And doing your audit and you come to him with the results, he sometimes doesn't believe that he has systems, you know, that have been installed for 5 years and he came 4 years ago and he doesn't know about. So there are so many systems and so many information provided with these systems that it's really impossible to manage and to take your decision upon the data of these systems. This was a generic view of the challenge of cybersecurity. Now, if you look at the attackers, so sometimes, as I said, attackers come from outside the organization, maybe through the internet, or maybe not through the internet. Maybe they manage to get someone, an insider employee, or an insider authority, has someone that has authority, or a vendor that is working in one of the supply chains of the organization, and to install some kind of a malware. So when we look at the layers of the analytic of cyber protection, we can look at few layers. So you can see that when we want to understand the cybersecurity of an organization, we need to look at user behavior. So this is a cultural issue when you see that you tell a corporate that they have to collect intelligence on their own employees. But this is really a normal practice that has to be adopted, because otherwise, as I said, your security will be jeopardized extremely. So then you have to collect information about your network behavior analytics. So what's going on your networks? Real-time behavior analytics, what's real-time activity in the network? And as you see, big data analytics to identify suspected activities. So big data, it means that you have a lot of information, but you have a system, as I said, that analyzes and finds correlation with it within those systems. And of course, external intelligence analytics, it means that you have to look outside of your organization for intelligence, open source intelligence, and collect information related to your organization. If your organization is a critical infrastructure, let's assume in India a critical infrastructure, and so beside the open source intelligence, we would recommend that they go to the intelligence authorities of India, that they have capabilities that you don't have by law. You can't collect information by law, what they can do, and ask them to be part of their to a gathering. And if you're important enough, make sure that they also gather for you your information. And in the end, that's what we want to achieve, is alert management to see what is going on. The response we have developed for this is what we call integrated security. It means that we try to put in one system all the information that we can gather. What we see here is, for example, SOC. You know what is SOC? Yeah, SOC is a security operations center, or DLPs, data leakage prevention systems that are you can have. They have IT events of your system. Sometimes when a software stops functioning in a, for example, in a financial institution or any organization, people think that it is only a matter of a software problem, but it can be a cyber event. It can be something that happens intentionally, or something that is connected to something that is happening intentionally. So in which case we would like to gather this kind of information. External and internal intelligence, as I mentioned, business operations events. It means that if something happens with your business line of action, because every organization has its own business to conduct, so if something happens with your business, collect this information. Physical security, as I mentioned in the previous slide, energy management as well. So all of this information has to be collected to one system and be fused, trying to find correlation between events. There are commercial softwares now available to trying to find this kind of correlations. And when you find these correlations, you try to provide what we call an early warning, to say, okay, we have something, we found something, let's see what happened. So you must know that, for example, the target attack last year, where I think 80 million credit card credentials were stolen from target of client credit card credentials, was conducted some few months. I think it took about 5 or 6 months through the whole operation. They identified this attack after a couple of months. However, it continued while they were trying to stop the attack. It continued 3 months. Continued. So this is something that if you are not aware of what's going on in your system, you don't have any forensic capabilities, you have a big problem, and you're not having to find correlation between all the events in your activity, then you have a big problem. So this is the ISA, the integrated security approach. This is what we call our cycle, is begin with early warning, trying to prevent, once you gained your early warning from intelligence or whatever you from correlation of events on your system, you try to generate an early warning. Try to prevent what will happen. If you can't prevent, then you hope you will detect when it happens. And if you are not able to detect, try to react once it happens, and recover as much as you can. This is the four points of our integrated security approach for any organization. Now, when you look at the tech kill chain, when you look at the four points that I just mentioned, look at the top, will show you how the attack kill chain is. There are many kill chain methodologies. We just choose one of them, which is try to the attacker will try to do some reconnaissance. then he will try to weaponize his systems based on the reconnaissance and intelligence that he gained. Okay, then he wants to deliver his system. Exploit is the point where he actually puts the attack in action. Control, it's that the malware is communicating with the control system. Execute, then it's executed what it wants to do, either steal information or do some kind of damage to your system. And maintain, that means that you try to maintain your ability to continue to act until you are discovered. Our approach goes exactly with those systems, as you see at the bottom line. We have the early warning trying to detect the reconnaissance activity of the attacker. We are trying to prevent the activity before the exploit is taking place. Once the exploit takes place, we're trying to detect it. And in the end, once we did not manage, because we all know that any defense line is bound to be penetrated, we're trying to react and recover. So that I mentioned the target issue, and I don't want to go further. I think my time is also, it's okay? Yeah, so we have, you know, two incidents. I think I would, we have target and we have WikiLeaks or Snowden. Well, we better go to Snowden. So target, as I mentioned, you saw target was a very important attack, important not for target because the managing director found himself out of his job. However, we could learn a lot of this attack because the what you could see that once you did the postmortem of this attack, you could see that all systems have identified some kind of activity, some kind of suspicious activity. However, it's like the elephant. There was no integrated picture. There was no system that could integrate between those isolated alerts to generate an overall early warning. So this was the main problem. And once they have generated, once they have understood that they were under attack, they did not have any good forensics capability to understand what is the attack doing, what it is trying to achieve. And thus, the attack continued months after they have identified. So this is a lesson learned. Another lesson to be learned is, of course, Snowden, which was working for a vendor for NSA. You know that Snowden conducted he collected his information in very weird hours, very late at night, and no physical. I mean, the physical systems detected it. I mean, he was. The system knew that Snowden was in the building. Nobody thought it was something odd. System understood that Snowden is extracting out of his computer a lot of documents, but nobody thought it was an event. Again, you could see that many indicators show that you have something going on, but again, the same example of the elephant. Nobody could see the real picture until Snowden reached I think, Hong Kong. So, even in this big security organization, when you could expect that they would have understood this this logic, it did not work. And should you have systems that could do correlation between different indicators that raise signals in your system, it would have been. I mean, I assume that the damage would have been minimized. You know. I'll give you a simple example. If you work in a corporate and you decide to leave your corporate for, you know, in 2 weeks, you want to notify your boss that you're going to leave. What would a typical employee do? What do you think? I know in Israeli culture that I know, but I don't know in India's culture. What then that employee will do if he knows he's going to leave his corporate? Let's say, assume he's working in a big law firm, okay? He will collect all the client information, yes? You want to avoid that. That would we people would do. So how would you ever find out that he's collecting information, taking out information of your systems because he wants to go to your competitor and use this information for his own good? You don't have any way of detecting it unless you have systems that will detect it. And so It's a cultural issue, I know, because I presented the client we had in India, for example, with the concept of surveilling employees. That's what we do, because everybody is trustable in Israel. However, let's make it a bit more trustable, yes? So it looked like a very odd thing to do. However, I think in time they are getting more and more convinced that that's what they should do. There are firms that will follow your cellular activity. So if this is your line of work and that's what you want to work for an organization, and the secrecy or the privacy or the data of the organization is critical, they want to protect it, and they should make sure that their employees are not being part of this vulnerability. As I said, employees and internal threat are a big issue in cybersecurity. Just to wrap up, I'll just mention again that when we look at security, we should look at it as an integrated a problem with an integrated solution. So do not try to separate between physical and cybersecurity. Have them all together, but when you go to a financial institution here in India, you will find the physical guy in one department and the cyber IT guys in another department. They don't speak with each other. This is a problem, and you have to overcome this cultural problem and internal political problem. However, this is if you want to protect your organization, that's what you should do. And once you integrate everything, have systems that will make you able to digest and analyze all the information that you get together to make good correlation, to find good early warnings, so you can react to what is going on. Okay? Thank you very much.
That whole problem begins to fundamentally transform the way we need to work and where we act in collectives, whether it is companies or countries or states. I mean, I think that's really... And I think the Laplace is surely a demon, I think, that is hovering all around us. Now, can I move to Latha Reddy to speak? And before that, I mean, I forgot to mention at the beginning that we have a hashtag. So those of you who are tweeting, that there is hashtag is ORF Cyber. So if you want to put out something, so it's public. So.
Thank you. May I first congratulate Siboni on what is a very thought-provoking presentation. I was taking furious notes because I found the concept of the demon very fascinating and your integrated security approach. I also wanted to mention that I'm delighted to be here, particularly today, because this is the first ORF event I'm participating in as a fellow of the ORF. And I'm delighted to join the ORF family. I've interacted with the ORF on several occasions in the past, both when I was in the government and after I retired. And, you know, I look forward to contributing more to ORF's work. What I'm going to speak about is quite different from the nuts and bolts of cybersecurity or cybersecurity systems. What I'm going to talk about is the ecosystem itself in which the entire cyberspace operates. And a very important part of that ecosystem is the global internet governance ecosystem, because there has been a lot of debate on the question of internet governance. As you all know, the major debate has been the multi-stakeholder model versus the multilateral model. The Tunis agenda and the WSIS agenda clearly indicated a very important role for governments and for states. The multi-stakeholder model, on the other hand, has been talking about the need for a free, open, unfragmented internet, and the fact that it has been created by the private sector, and therefore it should remain in the hands of the key multi-stakeholders, be they the private sector or be they the technical organizations that run the internet. And the goal of the multi-stakeholder model has been not to have a UN-led or a government-led system in any way to govern the internet. The question is that, firstly, I don't think it's entirely true to say that the internet was purely created by private sector or by academia, because there certainly was a lot of government funding and a lot of defense government funding which inspired that research and that creation of this very powerful medium, which is today transforming all our lives. I think secondly, when the internet becomes as powerful a force and not just an intellectual pursuit indulged in by a few, there certainly would be a lot of questions of how the internet should be regulated or governed. Since today the internet and connectivity permeate every area of human existence, there are also threats which have emerged, whether it be cyber crime or the use of cyberspace for terrorism, the attacks, the theft of intellectual property, the espionage in companies and businesses. So I think this is the real issue. And of course, there has been debate in the UNGGE. There has been debate in UN-led agencies, such as the ITU at both Dubai and more recently at Busan. Now, the real dilemma for many countries has been that the present system has been hugely dominated by US-owned corporations, US-owned entities, and the major part of the servers being in the US. And yet, the internet is an international medium used by the whole world. This has really been the root cause of the debate over internet governance. And the question being asked is, can it continue in its present form? India and China will be the largest internet user for the foreseeable future, as it is in the world economy, as it is in many other areas. They will be the largest contributors, in a sense, to both use of the internet and at some stage perhaps also become hubs for hardware as well as software services affecting the internet. The question is, should not these large countries have a say in how the internet is governed? There have been systematic attempts to, in a sense, demonize the multilateral model and influence the global discourse on the whole question of internet governance. The idea is that anything led by the UN, anything led by governments is necessarily bad, will necessarily stifle innovation, creativity, the ability for normal people to have access to the internet, etc. And there has been an attempt to glorify the free and open nature of the internet and the respect for human rights and privacy. And yet, at the same time, the same proponents of this theory of human rights, of privacy, have also been, essentially, we mentioned the Snowden revelations, Siboni. I think that has clearly shown that there's not been much privacy or much respect for human rights where the huge surveillance systems are concerned. So there's a little bit of a double standard which is operated on the debate on how internet should be governed. I think if you were to look at the present state of play, it's quite interesting because I've talked about what would be the traditional view of the US, its allies, Europe, Western democracies, if you like. Now you take the view of China. It's very interesting because the Chinese position has evolved. I find that, for instance, the latest pronouncements from China, the latest ideas that they have, the fact that China is now beginning to engage very actively with organizations such as Net Mundial and ICANN, which it was not in the past, China seems to favor a sort of modified multi-stakeholder model where it is of business interest to them. So they are prepared to, and yet at the same time, they would continue to espouse in the UN and other forums the multilateral model. So I think the BRICS statement, which has come out recently, is very interesting. I was just going through that yesterday when I was preparing my remarks for today. The BRICS statement is interesting because it has both what Russia would want and what others would want. So it says everything should be they should set up a working group. There should be equal footing for all states. The UN must play a facilitating role in setting up internet public policies. The BRIC statement also says we want an open, non-fragmented and secure internet. We acknowledge the need to promote principles of multilateralism, democracy, transparency, mutual trust, and universally agreed rules of conduct. I think the important point that was made in the BRIC statement is the evolution of internet governance ecosystem should be open and a democratic process, free from influence of any unilateral considerations. This is a very significant, and when you think that BRICS means China has accepted this formulation, India has accepted this formulation, Russia has accepted this formulation, so has Brazil and South Africa. And these are countries that adopt fairly different postures in international fora on these issues, and yet they were able to come up with this joint statement. The concerns that BRICS have expressed are crime, offensive tools, terrorism, mass surveillance and data collection. But significantly, they also oppose the violation of the sovereignty of states, and they stand for human rights, including the right to privacy. So as you can see, there's a very complex approach being taken, with all states talking about inclusivity, but inclusivity seems to mean different things whether you're talking about the multilateral or the multi-stakeholder system. So you, to get a look at the global ecosystem, you have to look at the traditional position taken by the US and Europe, which, if I may summarize, says if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And you have to look at the Chinese and Russian positions, which began with a purely multilateral approach, and at least in the case of China seems to be evolving, I would say, even in the case of Russia, if you look at the BRIC statement. Brazil and South Africa seem to yo-yo, because I find that Brazil, for instance, when they did the Net Mundial, in the run-up to the Net Mundial, talked a lot about the need to democratize the internet and to create new models. But at the Net Mundial itself, more or less went along with the multi-stakeholder model. But it was interesting, at an event which was actually organized by ORF at The Hague, parallelly with the Global Conference on Cyberspace, the Brazilian representative went out of their way to explain that when they said the system should be multi-stakeholder, they meant both multilateral and multi-stakeholder. In other words, there should be stakeholders from all over the world, not necessarily stakeholders only from one part of the world or one country. So, when you have to look at all of this, the agreement between China and Russia on cybersecurity or information security cooperation, the BRICS position, the Brazil and South Africa position, the Russian position, and the Chinese position, you add into this very volatile mix the geopolitical realities of the world today. You know, there is obviously, because of Ukraine and Crimea, but the Raja is much better qualified to talk on these security issues. Obviously, there's also a certain antagonistic posture which has developed between Russia and Europe and the US, which you see reflected in all dialogues, including the internet governance dialogue. So this is to set the context of what kind of ecosystem we're talking about when we talk about internet governance. I'd now like to move to the Indian position. You know, the Indian position has been, again, a very interesting story. Let me first start by saying what we ourselves in India did when we were looking at the overall question of cybersecurity and internet governance. We had been working on this for some time, but I would say in a more sporadic and an unconnected way, and perhaps working in too many silos without adequate coordination. I would say the serious effort by our government began, in a sense, we had always recognized the importance of this field. The very fact that we're one of the very few countries in the world to have a ministry or a department of IT, that which is now, of course, goes by the wonderful name of DAT, you know, which I think is a very funny acronym, stands for the Department of Electronics and Information Technology. And perhaps it's quite appropriate because internet is the new god, you know, for all of us, it's DAT. You also have a Department of Telecom, and this is very interesting with the debate on internet governance and internet usage spilling over into the telephony area, because with the advent of modern telephones, etc., the telecom agencies, whether in India or elsewhere, have all been arguing that they are not simply a means to provide channels for the internet to move through. You know, for a long time, the debate was the IT authorities will determine how IT is to be run or how the internet is to be controlled, and the telecom people are merely providers of cables and networks through which the information will be transmitted. I think the debates which you saw at ITU in Dubai and in Busan, in a certain sense, are now being reflected nationally inside internal systems, because the telecom guys are saying, we are also major players. We should get a say in how internet is run. We're not simply a provider of a channel, because we run the telephones, we run the telecommunications. We need to be part of this debate. There is resistance to that, because it would only multiply the number of a fora where these internet governance issues will be discussed. But, you know, I think these very same contradictions have been reflected in the Indian system as well, with both telecom and IT departments jockeying for position. In addition to that, because of the questions of crime and terror, obviously you have other departments within the government, home, defense, intelligence agencies, agencies set up to fight terror organizations or to track terror organizations, which have to, excuse me, did you say something? No.
Sure. No. External.
Yeah, external. And of course, as you said very correctly, the external policies, because it very often becomes a subject of foreign policy negotiations or in UN negotiations where external affairs would also be involved. Overall, it becomes a question of national security. And when I was in the National Security Council Secretariat, this is where we saw our role as a coordinating agency, which could perhaps talk about an overall architecture as to how this knotty question of cybersecurity and internet governance was to be addressed. So I would say in the period between 2000 and 11 to the present, a great deal of work was done in terms of defining these structures. And one thing which we were able to do was to set up a architecture that was agreed to by all departments of the government, and which I presume is still the architecture being followed. There has also been the question of setting up of a national cyber coordination center to be a cooperative venture between all government departments, but to be run by the IT ministry. Most importantly, the decision was taken to publish a cybersecurity policy for India, for the government of India. And this was released in August of 2013, and it's available, the text of the Cybersecurity Policy of India is available, I believe, on the DAT website. I think all of these were very welcome. I would say we were among the first countries to publish a cybersecurity policy. Not many countries have done so. And it very clearly spells out our concerns about cybersecurity. Apart from this, there was a recognition and an articulation of the fact that the government cannot achieve a safe cyberspace environment on their own, that you would need to bring in the private sector, you would need to bring in academia, you would need to bring in private experts, that government simply cannot operate on its own and introduce a secure system. That was essentially the reason why we set up the joint working group on cybersecurity between the government and the private sector. Again, this was an open group. We had representatives from all the associations. And I would say it came out with a fairly good report. And the interesting, I chaired this joint working group, and the interesting part of it was how much we agreed on, the government and the private sector. In general, we were about 10 people from the government, 10 people from the private sector, mainly association representatives. And there was a remarkable degree of synergy in agreeing on what were the points that we needed to work on, including on internet governance. And this really came up with some very interesting recommendations, including some pilot projects. I think there were four pilot projects identified that the government and the private sector should jointly set up a testing lab, that they should conduct a joint audit of a particular critical information infrastructure, that there should be a building up of a center of excellence together. You know, these were very concrete examples. We also identified a huge need for capacity building in this area. There is a serious shortage of cybersecurity professionals, both at the, I would say, at the very basic level as well as at the highly skilled level. The estimate there was about 500,000. I understand right now the various task forces and commissions who are looking at what we require have raised that even higher, and the figure may be closer to 1 million. So how are you going to train this number of people? You know, unless you build centers of excellence, you would have to use existing educational institutions like the IITs and the engineering colleges and introduce specific courses for cybersecurity studies where people are trained not just, and a whole host of other issues. You know, you would need to train lawyers, you would have to have a whole new system of law, you would have to have a jurisprudence which is built on how do you handle cybersecurity cases. Are cyber crimes to be judged by the same penal code as what is existing? It's obviously not adequate. The question of training police officials to handle these crimes and to record these FIRs, the need for special labs for where forensic abilities are developed. The whole gamut of this had to really be taken into consideration. And the other important thing, I think, was that there is a very systematic effort to identify critical information infrastructure sectors. As you know, critical information infrastructure, for the purpose of brevity, I'll call them CII. CII sectors are identified as sectors that would have a detrimental effect on national policies and national development, national security, if they are attacked. Traditionally, and this is not just in the case of India, all over the world, these would include sectors like, obviously, nuclear, space, if you have satellites out, and defense, but also very mundane day-to-day sectors which would affect our very existence. For instance, the banking sector, the financial institutions which would normally be put together, banking and financial institutions, the transport sector, which could include the railway networks, the road networks, air networks, civil aviation. And you would have power, because again, that's a very complex issue, particularly in a country like India, where you have a mix of both private sector and government running the power sector. How would you get everybody on board to introduce the same kind of checks and safeguards into their computerized systems? How would you handle a sector which is partially manually controlled and partially computerized? You know, these are very complex issues. Government has created a special nodal agency to handle critical information infrastructure, which is the NCIIPC, which the National Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Center. And they are in the process of working out specific sector-wise guidelines, recommendations. And as you know, we've always had a computer emergency response team, the CERT. We are one of the few countries to have a national CERT. Many countries have sectoral CERTs rather than national. We have both, but our sectoral CERTs need to be better developed. one of the problems in India is being a federal system or a quasi-federal system. What is happening in the center doesn't necessarily happen at the states. So that need for coordination between state and center also becomes very obvious. Now, moving to the question of the internet governance debate itself, which is what we are concentrating on, India has traditionally been treated as what they call a swing state. Because at times, because of our championship of a multilateral model, including the introduction of the CIRP at the UN in 2012, India was seen as standing more on the debate with China and with Russia, pushing for governmental controls. On the other hand, it was perceived that India has a very vibrant, active civil society, a very vibrant and active internet community who were arguing for more human rights, more privacy for the individual, and that'd be very difficult for India to have a system where you would say that you would control the internet or control the cyberspace within the country. This debate has been going back and forth, and it's interesting because from, I would say, 2012, where we seem to be espousing a multilateral or at least a partially multilateral model, because what we said at the CIRP in the United Nations was, India's proposal was that there should be a sort of a group of 50 countries, including India.
CIRP.
Yes, I said, what is, actually, I don't know what it stands for. That's a good point, you know. But it was a proposal put before the United Nations formally by India, suggesting some kind of a federation of states which were advanced in IT. And this never really progressed very far. There was very strong opposition from the US and from Europe, who saw this as a kind of a multilateral model and were not in favor of it. So that, I think, has really not advanced very very far, that model. But again, at the Net Mundial, India expressed a lot of reservations about blindly espousing the multi-stakeholder model and espousing the system as it stood today. And in spite of the efforts to project Net Mundial as a global consensus, that is, in my opinion, simply factually not correct, because neither Russia, nor China, nor India, nor a handful of other countries were party to the Net Mundial outcome at that time. This is simply to give you the background. It doesn't necessarily follow that this is today's position. And it has been very interesting because very recently there's been a lot of interest in the fact that the Indian Minister for IT and Telecom, Ravi Shankar Prasad, made a statement at the ICANN 53 in Buenos Aires on the 23rd of June, I believe it was, this year, saying and talked about the Indian vision for the internet. And in that he said, internet must remain plural, must be managed by a multi-layered and multi-stakeholder system. So for the very first time, the Indian government has clearly come out in support of a multi-stakeholder system. Its strength will lie in partnership made between like-minded nations and stakeholders, built on a platform which supports and will sustain a future of equity and innovation, collaboration and inclusion. Only then will we be truly able to manage the ecosystem of the new digital age. But I would say, while he said that India would support the multi-stakeholder system, he also said that India recognizes that all the stakeholders are key, and multi-stakeholderism is perhaps the only way to keep the system integrated, growing and expanding through new innovations and investments. But he did also say, not only do we support multi-stakeholderism, but we also encourage multi-stakeholderism itself to embrace all geographies and all societies. And there must be a digital democracy. It must be fair, it must be equitable, it must be open, but it must also be global and secure. I read with great interest Samir Saran and Mahima Kaul's comment on this statement by our minister, which incidentally was hailed with great enthusiasm by the US, Europe, and all this all those who espouse the multi-stakeholder model. His analysis, Samir and Mahima's analysis, was that India has opted for the multi-stakeholder system of global governance, but it is pushing for reform of the system to ensure it becomes more plural, more equitable, more geographically representative, and democratic. It's not going to be business as usual for those who are currently at the governance high table. And it does not blindly support the current system of domination by the US and Europe of the system. It wants an imminent rebalance towards Asia, that all this was also there in what India said. And the venue of the announcement has been very significant, because in the past, India has not, involved itself with ICANN in a very significant manner. The fact that the minister chose to make this announcement through a video address to ICANN is significant. He also indicated that India will organize a very major event, a global event on internet and internet governance issues. I think that the fact that India has made this forward movement, if you like, or has clarified its position. It's no longer seen as a swing state, but as a state that is for a multi-stakeholderism, although it is for a multi-stakeholderism that is reformed and more geographically representative and inclusive. Sami's conclusion was that US and India, as the largest net communities in the world in English, and also democratic net communities, must cooperate. And we must solve a lot of issues together. He has recommended that the US respond positively to this. And on the free access to internet issues, the strong security partnership to be built up. And, there should be deals on the logic layer and infrastructure, a bilateral deal around digital jurisdiction and territory, terrorism, more Indian presence in the corporations which currently rule the internet. And finally, there should be a root server in India. So, I think these are very interesting debating points. And I myself can tell you that from being a global commissioner on the Global Commission for Internet Governance, for being a fellow not just of ORF but also of EWI in New York, and attending many of the major global conferences around the world, there is keen interest in what position India will take. There is recognition that India will be a major player. There's been universal acclaim for the push towards digital India and the importance Prime Minister Modi has given to the internet. And there's an indication now, by setting up the task force in NASSCOM, that India should position itself as a hub for cybersecurity services, for trained cybersecurity personnel, and for cybersecurity solutions. And certainly India would want to be a major player in determining the internet governance debate. Whether or not we can achieve all these aims is a different matter. And that is something that only time will tell. But I think this is India's position. This is what India has done, this is particularly in the recent past. And we have to see which way this internet governance debate moves in the future. Thank you.
I think you wanted to come back on the privacy issue.
Just one issue related to Snowden, the issue of the concern that it raised about privacy. I think it's somewhat of a misunderstanding, because trying to fight terrorism with the machines collecting information on many people does not jeopardize, in my opinion, any privacy, because it's machine collecting information and they are not analyzing it. They are not personally analyzing, it's collecting big data information. However, they are only analyzing it when they have a signal of suspicious conduct or activity. Then they go into analyzing the personal activity of such a person. So I think that because I've been to many conferences and discussions where people are grieving about this kind of privacy violation, I don't see that the case. So I just wanted to put my opinion on. Maybe it's not very popular here, but I just...
No, but the state always violates privacy, so it's not a news for us. I mean, in India, the IB opens letters of in post offices. If you know someone is possibly a threat to national security, the telephones are tapped. So I think it's a long, historically a long tussle between producing collective security to individual rights. I think even in a democracy like India, I mean, I think where the question of how do you prevent, say, a massive communal disturbance or of public mobilization on an issue, then I think there India is tilted in favor of actually violating privacy or to be able to have state to have more control. But that debate, I think, goes on. I mean, I think it's not tumor. But I think, let me, before I open up, I mean, I think we've covered a whole range of issues from the philosophical foundations of how do you deal with this problem where you could not even be aware that you're being attacked, and how do you secure in that context the core functions of cybersecurity, to the global engagement on internet governance, as well as the challenges for India in terms of how does it devise both the cybersecurity policy at home as well as a position internationally, how does it negotiate at a time when the international system is actually making new rules, setting new guidelines, how does it cope with that? So I think it's a range of issues. I think the scope is very broad.